Support for WYES is made possible by Mary Lou Kristovich in memory of her husband, William Kristovich.
And welcome to Steppin Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, Ray Cannata of the crew of the Rolling Elvi. And great to see you.
Good to be here. Thank you, Peggy.
Very good to see you. And Steppin Out theater critic Alan Smason, editor of the Crescent City Jewish News. Poppy Tooker will return in 2 weeks. And, you know, we're so thrilled. As you can see, we just have two guests tonight because we have so many exciting video vignettes that we'll share. But first up, let's talk to Ray. How old's the crew of the Rolling Elvi right now?
Established in 2003. First parade was Muses in 2004. We've been with Muses ever since.
Wonderful. And we're talking about what? Lawyers, doctors, Indian chiefs, and ministers?
Yes.
Tell us about your day job.
I'm a senior pastor at Redeemer Presbyterian Church on Broadway in St. Charles.
That's great. Well, these guys, and just in case we have some newer New Orleanians, what we need to point out is when we say Rolling Elvi, our Rolling Elvi is depicting Elvis in various phases of his career, shall we say.
Yeah. They range from the ridiculous to the sublime, to the grotesque. Yes.
Uh-huh. As we chat,
every variety you can think of.
How many parades are you in this year?
We're in four.
Okay. Yeah. And as we chat, we'll show you some of those. But the scooters, that's also another part of what you do. Tell us about that.
Well, you know, as befitting royalty, you know, we're paying homage to the king. We don't walk. We ride on motorized mini scooters. Uh-huh. And each one is kind of, you know, souped up and personalized. But basically, they're like weed whackers with wheels. Yeah. 49cc gas scooters and some 1,000-watt electric scooters, too.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, tell us who you are tonight in terms of Elvi.
Oh, so I'm paying homage to kind of a bizarre version of the Jailhouse Rocker, you know, one of the iconic films of Elvis, because I'm also in the dance troupe. We have a dance troupe called the Jailhouse Rockers, and we also danced in Cleopatra this year.
And we should point out, though, that you're not just at Mardi Gras, that you all get together and really become ambassadors for different nonprofit events and kind of air cheer to it.
Yeah, we support the Odyssey House and all kinds of animal rights groups and all kinds of different charities in the city. We're also in Chris Owens Easter Parade and the DDD Christmas Parade and all kinds of other events year-round.
Well, I'm so glad that you're here, and I'm going to let Ray join his fellow Elvi, because we have a real Steppin' Out Mardi Gras tradition here. It's the crew of the Rolling Elvi fashion show. Let's visit with some of the Elvi, true blue to the purple, green, and gold.
Well, it's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe.
All right, I'm Hollywood. I'm with a contingent, the crew of the Rolling Elvi, the real kings of Mardi Gras. We're going to give you a fashion show. I'm wearing the Jailhouse Rocker costume from Elvis's iconic film. And first up is Terry. Tell us your Elvis name and what you're wearing.
My Elvis name is Harley, and I am wearing a Christmas outfit, and Elvis loved Christmas.
I'm Shane, and they call me Cake Belly in the crew. Now, this is the 1961 Blue Hawaii outfit. Little known fact, I was a stunt double in Blue Hawaii 5 years before I was born.
My name is Dave, and my Elvi name is DTR, and this is a rendition of 1972 when he was performing in Hawaii as well.
My name is Tony Love, a.k.a. Loverboy, and I'm celebrating Elvis's great Irish history with the Irish costume with the clover on the back. Come out and see me on the parade route. I got a ring for all you lovely ladies.
Hi, my name is Frank Hopkins. They call me Bunny. Elvis did three movies from 64 to 68 all about race cars, and he always had to work on them. He was always a mechanic, so that's me, the mechanic Elvis.
I'm Phil, known in the crew as Quackers. I'm wearing Elvis's wedding suit. Had he and Priscilla not divorced 8 years later, they'd be celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary, which the crew is celebrating in the parades they're in this year.
All right. Come
Come see us in the parades. Let's take it home, guys.
Well, you can do anything but take the help of my blue suede shoes. Well, it's blue suede shoes.
Yeah.
Blue suede shoes. Blue suede shoes. Well, you can do anything but take hold of my blue suede shoes.
Like aerobics. Yay! Here's to the crew of the Rolling Elvi. And just to remind you, you can see the crew of the Rolling Elvi and the crew of Carrollton Parade, and of course on the Uptown Route Sunday starting at noon. And New Orleans Magazine's quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Erica Stone named three carnival ball organizations that have the word of in their names. Elves of Oberon, Prophets of Persia, and Caliphs of Cairo, and there are a few more. Now tonight's question. With a nod to the NBA All-Star Game this weekend, New Orleans teams in the NBA have had two other mascot names. What were they? Plus, what is the name of the city's team in the old American Basketball Association? Oh, that's good. Email your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes. Tonight we have a year subscription to Louisiana Life magazine. Great story about the Cajun Mardi Gras there, too, by the way. We also have a $50 gift certificate from our friends at Kitchen Witch Cookbooks. And they are hosting a vegan pop-out outside of their store. That's tomorrow from noon to 3, rain permitting, and will also offer complimentary wine inside. And they're still hosting their Hump Day happy hour every Wednesday from 5 to 7 p.m. We also have a copy of Errol LaBorde's book, Mardi Gras, Chronicles of the New Orleans Carnival, courtesy of Pelican Publishing. You can visit WYES.org for our online calendar to see our lineup of events. You can also link to our WYES YouTube channel to view our program. Very exciting. Tonight, we have a very special artist spotlight. Carnival Fetes and Feasts is the theme for this year's Rex Parade. Here's an exclusive look at this artistic tribute to carnivals here and around the world.
While we in New Orleans are proud of our own celebration of Carnival, it's fitting that the 2017 Rex Parade gives an elegant nod to carnivals around the world and from antiquity. The theme, Carnival Fetes and Feasts. Rex organization archivist, Dr. Stephen Hales.
One can go to Spain, to Hungary, to Russia, to every corner of the world and find beautiful celebrations, beautiful images. We also go back in time. In antiquity, many celebrations of springtime became adapted by the church. Early Christians were already celebrating in the spring. So many of those celebrations, Lupercalia, Saturnalia, were incorporated into the church calendar.
Henri Schindler is the artistic director for the Rex Parade.
The idea for this parade was actually Dr. Hale's idea. And I thought it was marvelous. And we worked together on drawing up a list of the feasts and festivals and carnivals. The sketches are done by Manuel Ponce, who has been working on Rex design since the early 90s. And he's part of a great team that I've been working with now for 20 years.
When you're working on a parade year-round, it's inevitable that there are some favorite floats.
My favorite float this year is the Peruvian float, Diablada, which is the Dance of the Devils, and it's spectacular. The figure on the front is really superb. It's very detailed. The whole parade is beautifully painted, but this float in particular speaks to me. Raymond Bowie did his usual outstanding job of painting the entire parade. And Randy Ernst did a fabulous job, as always, with his flowers. The flowers on the Diablo float are particularly fine with their pearl centers.
One of my favorite floats, a very colorful figure, is the Busajaris. This is a float that honors a celebration in Hungary. Centuries ago, when the Ottoman Turks had invaded Hungary, the citizens of a small village there had disappeared into the woods to hide from the Turks. One stormy night, they all donned very scary masks, made lots of noise, came out of the woods, and legend says the Turks fled and never came back.
A must for inclusion in the rolling tableau is Carnival in Venice, of course, and for a special reason.
They're renowned for their costumes and their masks. Of course, we have a float honoring that. We also discovered that NOMA is mounting a beautiful exhibition of Venetian art from the 18th century. This is going to allow some lovely collaborations with NOMA. Some of the imagery on our float honors some of the images you will see when you visit NOMA.
For Rex, there's yet another connection to Italy and New Orleans.
Another one of my favorites is the Via Reggio float, because the Via Reggio carnival has been very influential in our carnival. When Blaine Kern started bringing over props from Europe in 1959 and in the early 60s, they all came from Via Reggio. And the work was done by the Berticelli family, Raul Berticelli, who moved here with his family in around 1970. And just a few years ago, his son, Jonathan Berticelli, built the spectacular figure for the Rex Butterfly King, which is highly animated, like all the figures in Via Reggio. The head moves, the eyes roll. It's really spectacular.
And also a part of the Rex Parade is a tribute to another American city where Carnival is celebrated.
I think my favorite float honors some history very close to home. The Mystic Memphi, an organization in Memphis, Tennessee, was formed the same year as the Rex organization. The figure on this float is taken from one of the few surviving images of one of their parades. They actually thought they rivaled New Orleans in terms of the beauty of their parades, so there's quite a rivalry there. After a yellow fever epidemic, Memphis almost went away, and the parade certainly did. We still maintain a close connection to Memphis. Many members of Carnival Memphis come down to celebrate with us, and we return the favor and visit with them.
And even closer to home is a float depicting the Cajun Carnival, known as the Coureur de Mardi Gras.
Things added to make the parade stand out as a day parade are particularly the heavy use of gold leaf. Rex has probably more gold leaf than any other parade that rolls. Even when the sun's not shining, the glare is enough to make it sparkle. And it also flutters. It adds another degree of movement. The Rex float in particular, the King's float, is almost solidly leafed, and will give you an idea of how important that element is.
Carnival, of course, we know is connected to the Catholic Church calendar. Carne Vali, farewell to meat, symbolizes the very last meat eaten before the Lenten period. Shrove Tuesday then was always a period of celebration. But that celebration before giving everything up for Lent exists in many cultures and has been around for a very long time.
Mardi Gras. Don't forget, the Rex Parade rolls Mardi Gras beginning at 10 a.m. on the St. Charles Avenue Parade Route. Look for the St. Aug Purple Knights celebrating the 50th anniversary of their appearance in the Rex Parade. By the way, some alums from 50 years ago will be riding in the parade and throwing some special throws commemorating that very special year. Also, WYS will be airing live the Rex, of course, the Rex Ball and the meeting of the courts of Rex and the Mystic Crew of Comus. Live from the Sheraton, Mardi Gras night at 7:30 p.m. with a repeat directly following right here on WYES. And now time for Alan.
And since Mardi Gras is my birthday, I'm giving everybody the day off, okay? Do not go to work.
Happy
have fun in the streets.
Happy birthday. Okay.
So back to theater. As a longtime critic, you know, I've been pleased to journey far and wide to see very good theater. In the past several seasons, you know, with founder Perry Martin at the helm of the Bayou Playhouse in Lockport, Louisiana. I've actually driven the hour's drive or so to go see some rather noteworthy shows. And I will tell you, some of them included Rising Water by John Biganay and also an excellent production of The Miracle Worker. Now that Perry's exited from Bayou, I had a chance to catch their first production. This was Christopher Sergel's adaptation of the beloved Harper Lee novel, To Kill a Mockingbird. The real-life attorney, Greg DeLeo, is a good choice as Atticus Finch. He plays the father of Scout, who is the narrator, essentially. In this particular play, however, the narrator is left to one of the other characters. It's set in that racially divided town of Macomb, Alabama. And Charlie-Ann Ferris plays Scout, she actually plays very well with Atticus on stage. It's a very big role, though, for a young lady. Carter Kreppel and Reagan Ferris are Scout's brother Jim and their friend Dill. Dominique McClellan plays Tom Robinson, the accused rapist whom Attican defends on trial. And again, an excellent performance by him as well. Mayella and Bob Yule, who are the accusers that are played by Lexi Richmond and James Ricker, also turn in very good performances. Two of the best players, of course, are veterans. That's Lance Nichols and Carol Sutton, who play both Reverend Sykes and the Finch housekeeper, Calpurnia. Overall, I found the play a bit uneven. Very good performances, but some that were a little bit less than that, a little bit more staid. I think the problem here is a little bit more in the directing by Tommy Myrick, who I don't believe spent as much time as she probably could have with the kids. Again, the adults, a stellar cast. I thought she could have gotten more out of people like Brenda Curran, Dane Rhodes, and Harold Evans. They should have had probably a little bit more better, more compelling performances. But at the end of the play, was I moved? Yes, I was.
Still,
the adaptation still a powerful, indictment against race and intolerance, against hate. The standard for directing, I believe, here probably should have been heightened a little bit. I expect that the Bayou will have a little bit more to come. We'll have more from them. I think they can do better, and I think they will. So we'll see what happens. But To Kill a Mockingbird, final weekend this weekend in Lockport. If you get a chance to go over there, I think overall it was a good production. But I just really wanted, with that cast, to have a little bit more. Now, speaking of theaters, the Valiant Theater, which has finally come into fruition, is right past the Orleans Parish St. Bernard line, if you will, that's in Araby. They have actually opened with their first production, which is actually another production company putting it on, but it's going to be something that everybody is probably familiar with, Alan Menken's Sister Act, which is, of course, the story that was done on film originally with Whoopi Goldberg. If you may remember, they did a version of this at JPS not too long ago. It's a story of a nightclub performer who goes on the lam and basically hides out in a convent with the nuns and has quite an effect on them. This is going to be on March the 10th through the 19th. Now, I'm mentioning it because, as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to be gone for a couple of weeks, so I wanted to make sure that anybody who has an opportunity, this is a community theater production, and I'll get a chance to go see it probably that very first weekend and be able to do a review for it before it ends. Meanwhile, in Kenner, Theater 13, the artistic producing company behind the Kenner's Rivertown Theater of Performing Arts, they're dusting off an old production that they had and bringing it back. It's the funny return of Alfred Hitchcock's The 39 Steps. Now, if you're not familiar with this, this is where basically four people play all of the parts of 150 different characters in the Alfred Hitchcock movie. Yes. So you've got Richard Hannay, played by Mark Fushi, of course, and then Jesse Terrebonne plays all of the female parts. There are, I think, five or six. And then everybody else is played by either Gary Rucker or Mason Wood. Now, Gary played in this in 2010. He was, I believe, Comic 1. This time he's going to be Comic 2 or vice versa, whichever it was. He's going to do the different roles that Sean Patterson had done, but this time Mason Wood is stepping in for him. So that should be a lot of fun. And again, I was having a great time with it the last time I saw it in 2010. It's only got to get funnier. So that'll be at Kenner Rivertown Theaters. That, again, will be in March the 10th and ending through the 26th. Meanwhile, at Le Petit Theater in the French Quarter, don't forget that they're going to have some other events coming up, and I wanted to let everybody know about the 100th anniversary of the passing of Scott Joplin. For that will be Richard Dowling. The people at the Musical Arts Society of New Orleans, MASNO, will be presenting him doing Scott Joplin music on the piano at Le Petit. It should be a wonderful show. That'll be on Sunday, March the 12th. And I believe the tickets are only $25. Tickets, I think, are available at Le Petit, and you can get that online. Meanwhile, the first production shots in advance of the Tarzan the musical, the Disney musical that has been, you know, made into a musical on stage, we get to see Jane for the first time. This is Christian Tarzetti. Yes, Tarzetti is in Tarzan. I don't know how they did that, but there she is. And James Joyce Williams will be playing the title role. He's going to be, the featured performer in Tarzan. But you should make plans to go see that. That'll be in March as well. We're looking forward to that on Airline Drive at the Jefferson Performing Arts Center.
All right. Thank you very much, Alan. You know, it has been 100 years since Storyville, that local legalized red light district, was officially shut down. Since it lasted from approximately 1898 to 1917, let's try to imagine the place at Mardi Gras. Situated on the edge of the quarter, Storyville was full of stories. And actually, here are a few.
Storyville, New Orleans' legalized red light district, ran from 1897 to 1917. The restricted district, as it was called, had very few restrictions, especially during Carnival.
All the courtesans in town appeared to be out, many in male costumes of all kinds, from the pimp of Canal Street dandy to the rollicking drunken sailor of Gallatin Street and the green flatboatman of Perdido Street.
In the late 19th century, Storyville started their own balls, known as the French balls. These were created by the two well-known gentlemen and quickly copied. Carnival, in the Victorian age, was especially relished by those in Storyville as it meant the strict class system could be ignored and mocked, if only for a day. Even the lowliest prostitute could mock the richest businessman on Mardi Gras Day.
The two well-known gentlemen, one was very well-known, who was Tom Anderson, who was a saloon owner and the unofficial mayor of Storyville, and the other was Leon Lamote, who was also a restaurant and saloon owner and brothel owner. The two well-known gentlemen were the most established and the most popular. Tom Anderson was born in the Irish Channel. He was born very poor, and he basically worked his way up. And while a lot of the typical underworld bosses kind of ran things with an iron fist, Anderson subscribed more to speak softly and carry a money stick.
White men paid a premium price to attend the French balls, but tickets were free for the women who worked in brothels, cabarets, and dance halls. For the less courageous, visiting Storyville on Mardi Gras Day was a must. In between parades, they would take in the ornateness of Josie Arlington's $5 house, try to steal a glance at the Countess Willie Piazza's girls, and hope to view one of the bedrooms of Lulu White, which were covered, walls and ceiling, in mirrors.
I would say that in the French balls, liberal doses of nudity probably had a lot to do with the way they viewed the upper classes. And of course, the thing about the people who worked in Storyville is quite a few of their customers were members of the social elite. And so when they were mocking these individuals, they were probably had specific references. It's probably a good idea to think about two diametrically opposed concepts of fantasy. The social elite, their fantasy is based on Ivanhoe and Sir Walter Scott and kings and queens and princes. For the underclass, denizens of Storyville, their idea of fantasy is really more frivolous, more salacious, having to do with fun, how everyday people enjoy their off time.
Mask or full evening dress, absolutely required. Positively no tickets sold at the door.
CCC Club Ball. Carriages will approach the French Opera House. Invitations are strictly personal and must not be transferred.
The dances that were performed at the French balls would be the slow drag, the shag, the belly rub. You can see already that the comparison's very different. We see a movement away from these sort of group dances like the quadrille to more participatory close couple dancing like the waltz, but ultimately it's leading for young people to the slow drag. The slow drag is extraordinarily close close couple dancing.
Better known as the Parisian Queen of America, Emma's House of All Nations is one place of amusement you can't very well afford to miss while in the Tenderloin District. Everything goes here. Miss Denning has the honor of keeping one of the quietest and most elaborately furnished establishments in the city where beautiful women, good wine, and sweet music reign supreme. Where one can have enjoyment unmolested and without being seen.
Storyville, like Mardi Gras, flourished for many reasons. A society within a society. It lived on the fringes of New Orleans, all the while navigating through low class, high class, and everything in between.
And a very special thanks to Sally Asher, Carrie Cahill, and Eva Contis for this historical vignette, and many more, but we really appreciate it. And now it's time for our picks. Ray.
All right, how about Muses? If I just pick one, Muses is our historic, it was our first parade, and we still do it every year. We've got lots of great throws. I brought a few of them for you here today. This year we have two dolls. We've been giving out voodoo dolls each year. This is the 50th anniversary of Elvis's wedding, so we're doing a wedding couple. There's going to be a wedding theme for Priscilla. And we'll also have D.C. Harbold once again performing with us. Over 100 riders, a whole truck of Priscilla, banner carriers, photographer. It's going to be a great show.
Sounds great.
Well, the next night, the crew of Hermes will be parading through the streets of New Orleans. They're going to have a Hermes miscellany, which I'm going to be privileged to be able to announce at Gallier Hall. So I hope that people will come out and check out the stands around there and the historic area there where parades have passed for generations.
Absolutely. And my picks, NOMA, New Orleans Museum of Art, is hosting Ferrari of Houston in partnership with the Ferrari Club of America as they display, and lots of local Ferrari owners, look at this Ferrari.
I'll take it.
This Ferrari. It's La Ferrari. It's a limited edition hybrid car. It was auctioned off for $7 million. And other vintage cars and new models, as you see here, for New Orleans' first Concorso d'Eleganza, starting at 10 a.m. tomorrow in front of the museum. It is in conjunction with the museum's new exhibit, A Life of Seduction in Venice in the 1700s, on view through May 21st. Visit NOMA.org for more information on that. And don't forget the crew of stars tomorrow night at the Jefferson Performing Arts Center on Airline Drive in Metairie. We also want to share some great images of this year's Crew of Mid-City Parade. In Vino Veritas, that's the theme, since their reigning king and queen own a vineyard. And the floats are designed by the very talented Ricardo Pustanio. It's all foil, very unique, thanks to Jules Richard, who works with, of course, Ricardo, for these wonderful, wonderful pictures. And the parade rolls Sunday, February 26th at 11:45 on the Uptown Route. Also, we have some images from this year's Crew of Bacchus Bash, or from last year, we should say. It's an all-day block party next to Generations Hall. VIP tickets can be purchased on the Bacchus website. And they're saluting the Saints' 50th anniversary, rolling Sunday, of course, and also on the Uptown Route also, too. We want to also show you, before we go, we'd like to show you some show and tell us, a Mardi Gras throws. What a surprise. It's a shoe.
Whoa.
What could that be? Muses, right?
Yes.
Also, we've got this little rubber ducky. Some very special floats are going to be in the parade relating to this guy, okay? We also have Friday night. I want to show you my pin. That's Coup d'Etat. And this is a hologram, one of these terrific cups, at the hologram of Coup d'Etat itself. All kinds of great things. By the way, next week we'll be presenting Steppin Out, It's Carnival Time. That's our annual overview with Errol Laborde and Arthur Hardy. And happy Mardi Gras. And thank you for watching. Good night. All right.
Yeah, right.